works.
Can you hear me all right?
Okay. I'm from Holland. Nijmegen, where the last Experience Design Conference was. And in Holland, whenever the text company reaches out for you, you find blue envelopes lying on your doorstep. So, one of these days, 2 years ago, something strange happened to me. I came home thinking I paid all my taxes, and still a blue envelope was on my doorstep. So I had to open it up, but then it wasn't the tax company that wrote me a letter.
It was something else.
And I want to read this letter out to you. Nijmegen, April 13th, 2016. Dear Niels, we don't know each other, so forgive me for this intrusion on your privacy. A mutual connection, whose name I unfortunately can't tell, pointed me in your direction. I need help. My name is Harold. I'm a journalist, and the reason I'm reaching out is as follows. In April 2015, I was working in the library of Mazarin in Paris, and I focused on this amazing story about the Alpha, one of history's best-kept curiosities. Although I put in months of hard labor, I never got to finish this project. One of the final days in Paris, I was examining a book of Eschenbach on clues about the Aleph. This is when I discovered somebody had been scribbling notes on the pages of this book. One of the pages even pushed through on the next page. Curious as I am, I wanted to find out just what it was he or she wrote down. As a journalist, you tend to find the most exclusive things if you push through your search. After a while, I nearly deciphered the notes. This marked the beginning of an amazing journey. It took me through Europe and even further. I've seen the mountains of the Pyrenees. I went to Jerusalem, Glastonbury, Siena de Montesepi. I've even traveled the Far East to find out whether what I was about to discover was really actually true. Now, for the last 2 years, I've worked on nothing else but this project. But I got tangled up. I'm sure if I find what I'm looking for, and it really turns out to be true, it will change the face of the earth. However, I got stuck, and I mean really stuck. I'm afraid I got in too deep, and though I don't like to admit it, I must say I need help badly. This is why I'm reaching out to you. And then there was this little note, maybe I can find it. There was a cipher code on the letter. And I didn't know what to do. Now, I'm married to Minne, my wife, obviously, so we were sitting on the couch in our living room, and there was a cipher code. So we decided to fill in the cipher code on the internet, on Google, and it turned out to be the geographic location of an ancient castle in the center of Nijmegen. So we could only come to one conclusion. We had to go there. And we went there that same afternoon, and we climbed one of the towers, hoping to find something. And since I couldn't find anything, I said, Minne, let's go home. I don't know what's going on. But then she pointed out, between the rocks, there was this little note addressed to me, saying, please contact me through internet. You'll find me. I had to destroy this note, but I liked it too much, so I kept it. I had to go to this specific website, and I got in contact with this Harold person. And the next day, maybe 2 days later, I received yet another blue envelope, which I'm not going to read out to you, but there was one thing in there which really caught my attention. It was a picture, I'll show it out a bit bigger, of an ancient building. And I didn't know what to do with it. So I thought, well, I must analyze and find out what this building is. And I posed this question on Facebook. And then people told, does anybody know this building? It's a castle in Glastonbury, where supposedly King Arthur was buried. And if it wasn't King Arthur, then they say the Holy Grail must be buried over there. So from that moment on, I knew I was looking for the Holy Grail. I had to find the Holy Grail. And then for about a month, blue envelopes kept entering my house. And they gave me all these things to do. So I had to enter the local bookshop, order a specific book about Don Quixote. And then he sent me, I got a cipher code. And then by deciphering certain words in the book, I find the next code. And so I continued my journey for a month. Then, one day, I came home. No more blue envelopes. On that day, I found an orange envelope on my doormat. Addressed to me, written by a person who introduced himself as Q. Obviously, he couldn't tell me his real name. And he warned me. He told me, listen, Nils, I know Harold traced you down. But you have to trust me, Harold is your enemy. Be afraid, be very afraid. From now on, don't trust anybody else but me. And I'll prove it to you because I had my detectives tracing down Harold, who's already in Nijmegen, so you're in great danger. And they traced down the route he's walking through town. Please use this map and then apply his route to this map. And when I applied his route to this map, I could decipher a code written on the map. It was the name of Parsifal, one of the fellow friends of King Arthur. So from now on, I was in this big dilemma, knowing I had to eventually trust Q. And then one of the last letters I received was the invitation, actually the order, to go to the railway station on the 5th of May, order a cup of coffee under the name Parsifal, and it said, bring clean underwear and your passport. So I arrived at the railway station, I asked for a coffee. They said, here's your coffee. I said, yeah, well, I'm Parsifal. Ah, you're Parsifal. In that case, we have to give you, and I got this big brown envelope, which is somewhere around here. We have to give you this envelope, and we have to give you this small card. And with this card, you can unlock a locker on the station. And when I unlocked the locker, I found a ticket to Amsterdam. And yet, the last envelope, the last orange envelope. So it said, jump in the train and go to Amsterdam right now. And please only open this last envelope when you're 10 minutes away from Amsterdam. So 10 minutes away from Amsterdam, because I tend to listen pretty closely when I'm in danger. I didn't open it any minute before 10 minutes to Amsterdam. I got to open the last envelope. And I want to read out the last letter Q wrote to me. Nijmegen, April 2017. Dear Nils, hopefully when you read this letter, it will be less than 10 minutes before we finally meet on Amsterdam Central Station. That's to say it will be Q whom you'll meet. Maybe by now you know exactly what's going on. Maybe it's all still a big mystery to you. I don't know. What I do know is that eventually I will sign this very letter with my own name. That's my promise to you. So let me explain a little bit about Q to you. Q's adventure started out 10 years ago, as did ours. The Holy Grail, I found out, turned out not to be a scale. It turned out not to be some sort of holy stone. The Holy Grail turned out to be friendship. One might come to the conclusion that the Holy Grail turned out to be friendship over the last thousands of years. What King Arthur, Parsifal and so many others spent their life on searching for was actually friendship. May it be true or not, to me, our friendship is of a rare and priceless yet incredible value. To me, therefore, our friendship is the Holy Grail. Looking back over the past 10 years of my life, you were there at almost every highlight and stood by my side at every low. Always as a friend and more as one to lean on. I think Eschenbach, one of the writers, might have been right all along. This story, this quest I designed for you is my way of thanking you. Thanking you for 10 years of honesty, supporting, getting lost with me, experiencing the supernatural, having our fights and quarrels, mirroring me, laughing our guts out, crying our hearts out, and above all, the best adventure I ever had. Thank you for that. The adventure of Harold, Q, and Parsifal ends here. We'll be going back to our own adventure, and hopefully this adventure will last for years to come. Hopefully, in the end, we will be those two old friends, two old men, still staring down a little fire together. But that's yet to come. For now, I can only say, let's head up to Paris together. And when I left the train and I looked on the right side, my best friend, Michel, left that same train with a smile from ear to ear. And he designed this specific experience only for me in order to celebrate 10 years of friendship. That night, we drank wine underneath the Eiffel Tower. So, I've been telling this story for a lot of times already, but still. He aimed straight for the heart. That's what he did. He didn't just come up with a story about friendship and the things we've been through. He didn't just give me the experience of having a nice dinner and drinking a glass of wine. He didn't just throw in some game elements. He put them all together. And he stirred it to a soup that mesmerizes you, that enchanted me. I had not one moment of doubt whether I should or shouldn't follow up on the things that were asked of me. Not one moment. I dove in deep. Now, the fun thing is, since I still know Michel, of course, I talked to him about how he designed the experience. And there's a lot of technological things you can learn about it. There's a lot of theoretical things you can learn about it. But the most important thing to him, designing the experience, was just as much fun as for me to receive it. Because he had to dive in his diaries, he had to dive in the photographs, he had to think of every memory we shared together. Creating the experience was just as much fun and just as immersive as going through the experience. So, first of all, I can hardly express the gratefulness to Michel for doing that to me. But secondly, what happened is that I got fascinated by what happens to meet people when they're pulled into an immersive experience. And I think it's a terrain which is yet to be discovered. We're pioneering here. But I think it might be one of the most powerful tools if it comes to learning or enchanting people. And I started experimenting a little bit with that. So let me tell you a little bit of maybe who I am and what my trail of work within the experience designing business is. So in front of you is a guy who's been, as I was introduced, I've been running a consultancy company for not 20, but about 18 years. And a couple of years ago,
I encountered my first,
because I think there's more to come,
my first midlife crisis. You know how every now and then, to me it happens every 5 to 7 years, you start doubting everything in your life and you think maybe I have to change course entirely and do something. Well, that happens to me a lot. So, in that time, I decided to step out of the working cycle I was in and just allow myself some time to look around and feel whatever comes to mind. And I started taking tours through the city of Nijmegen, guided tours through the city of Nijmegen. Has any one of you been there, the last conference? Okay, Gary, you've been there. It's an ancient town. It was built by the Romans, so it's a 2,000-year-old town, so there's a lot to be told about Nijmegen. So it ended up in me developing a lot of experience, and I'll just pick out a couple, which I think may illustrate how immersive experience can help in the field of education. So when I was traveling around Nijmegen on these guided tours, I started to learn more and more about the city. And I saw myself walking downtown with my parents and explaining a lot about the city to my parents. So from a student, I became a teacher. And from a student, I became someone who really cares for the city. And then I got this feeling, why not create experiences for people to learn more about the history of Nijmegen? And the first thing I came up with was building an escape room. Do you know the concept of escape rooms? So you're being put in this mostly one room and three secret rooms. You have 1 hour to puzzle your way out. So I built a couple of escape rooms. And the first one I built had a double goal. It was for entertainment, but it was also for the educational purpose of getting people to know the history of Nijmegen. And I picked out a specific time plot. Nijmegen was heavily damaged during World War II. So this escape room was all about what happened during World War II. And let me just show you a couple of pictures to illustrate this escape room. I can't show you all because it would be a teaser, and if you want to go to Nijmegen, then you couldn't play it anymore. But one of the things is that in real life, the Nijmegen resistance used to have a cafe where they gathered together. Café de Bonte Os. And the building still exists in Nijmegen. So underground, we rebuilt that specific cafe. And if you escape the escape room in Nijmegen, you'll find yourself in Café de Bonte Os. And all the material in there that we bought or got our hands on is actually material from 1933. Which means it feels like, and it smells like, that specific period. I had people down there that really lived during the war, and they said, I smell the same smell that happened to me in that specific time. Now, I think this is often underrated, the look and feel of an experience. But it has to be real in order to become immersive. Now, what happened here is that this cafe is also a museum. By now, there's more clues on the wall. So the man standing behind the counter, in role, of course, as the bartender of 1944, can tell you that the clock stopped at 12:22, because that's the time the first bombardment destroyed the center of the city. And he can tell you a lot about history when you're in the cafe. So merging gaming and history works. And to my own astonishment, because it was my midlife crisis and not my goal, made the question emerge, what would happen if you would unwrap an escape room and smear it out over an entire city? So could you turn a city into an escape room? And this is where Nijmegen the game started. So the goal was for every citizen to Nijmegen, we ended up with a couple of hundreds of citizens, to learn more about the city. And my idealistic goal is that I still think if you learn about the history of a place,
in present times you treat it with more respect and more love because you know it deserves it because it's lived its life. So we started out Nijmegen the game. And what we did, this is the Dutch paper article about it. We made 40 of these iron tubes with a lock on it. And on it are names of historical figures of Nijmegen. For instance, the mother of Karl Marx used to live in Nijmegen. And we just hang them throughout the city. So we hung them from trees. We hung them from a bicycle where you can put your bike. We hung them from lamp sites. And the citizens of Nijmegen who were brave enough could just wrap it up, take it home with you, and they could puzzle it open. And 40 people actually did. And when they opened it, they would find a writing about the person whose name was written on it, so by that they would learn about history. But they'd also find a phone number. Now, if they called that phone number, a dark voice would say, "I'm so glad you finally found me. I need your help." And then yet another cipher code, which Michel taught me, obviously. And if they deciphered that code, they'd have to be in this ancient dungeon on the 16th of December at 6 o'clock. So it's cold in December in the Netherlands. On that 16th of December, people might come there, and 40 people were standing in front of the dungeon where two old monks would open up the door once they were gathered together. They would invite them in, so there were 40 scary people, two of my actors, really happy, walking down, and there would be a great dinner for them at a great round table. But one by one of these monks, who weren't allowed to speak, would come to you, look you deep in the eyes, and urge you to follow them down to the cellar. And in the cellar, they were shown a little movie, which I will show to you as well. Hopefully, sound works good for me too.
Welkom, speler. Goed dat je er bent. Je bent er bijna. Wat ik je zo ga vertellen, dat is geheim. In Nijmegen zijn er slechts enkele die het weten. En jij hoort straks bij die selecte groep. Kun je het geheim niet aan, dan heb je nu de kans om te gaan. We vergeten je gezicht en je naam.
Niks aan hand.
Kies nu. Of je blijft, of gaat.
Oké, je bent er nog.
Ik ga je zo meteen iets geven, iets belangrijks. Een teken uit het verleden. Wat bepalend is in de toekomst. Houd het altijd bij je, want je zult het later nodig hebben. Ik zal jou vragen mij te helpen, samen met anderen.
Je wordt belangrijk voor Nijmegen.
Je draagt nu een geheim bij je. Vertrouw het niemand toe, ook hier boven niet. Als ze vragen stellen, zeg dan dat je niets weet. We zien elkaar.
Er staat iets goeds.
And then they had to leave that dungeon. All holding a coin, which they didn't know at that time, but it granted them access to the musea of Nijmegen, to old churches, to old basements, to the community building, because we'd arranged for all of that. And the 40 players turned out to have to invite friends to join them and help them in their rescue of the city of Nijmegen. And they had to go to colleges by university professors whom we made up. So we made up this professor who retired from university, but who had been bullied during his time on university because he had this strange vision about a prophecy which had been lost and should have been restored. And his colleagues always told him he was crazy. And now that he was retired, he could finally speak out. And he had this conference in a big church in the center of Nijmegen. And people were invited to found what we call the prophecy of Nijmegen. And if it wouldn't be restored, Nijmegen would lose his place in history. So eventually, 200 people went out and played this game. And they had to go grave digging on the beaches of Nijmegen. They had to find stolen Bibles from the churches of Nijmegen, which were eventually found back on the top of the church towers. So what happened there is that in the end you could see citizens of Nijmegen recognizing each other from one of the events, and then they could show the coin and say, "You're one of us." "Yes, I'm one of them." And then they'd smile and just move on. So this was yet another moment for me to discover, whoa, what happens if you combine storytelling, gaming, and immersive experience? It lures you in. And then, as a final example, University of Nijmegen called me. And they said, "Listen, Niels, we're going to be celebrating our 95th birthday next year, and we would love for our students to know more about the history of our specific university. Can you build us an escape room in order to do that?" So we went to them, we had a lot of talks about it, and then you choose one specific topic from history, because I think one of the failures I see happen a lot is that people want to tell too much in too short of a time. I think you'd be better off taking one specific topic and really turning it into a beautiful story instead of telling a lot of stuff, but nothing will remain in head or heart. So we choose the period yet again, 1942, when Nijmegen University was the only university in the Netherlands that shut down. And it shut down because the Germans made it mandatory for every student to sign a paper that they were loyal to the Germans. And Nijmegen University didn't want to put its students at position, so it closed down. Which meant a lot for the resistance in Nijmegen. It had to go undercover. And one of Nijmegen's students at that time, Joseph, was one of the leaders of the Dutch resistance. So he had to go undercover. And this Joseph really existed. So he went out to meet his niece, who still lives. And she told us a lot about Joseph. And she told us what his room was like and what he lived like. And we rebuilt his entire room. And we rebuilt the society he lived in. And I just want to show you one last movie of how people can be lured into an experience as that. This is Nijmegen the game. This is the experience, Radboud University experience.
Het is april 1943. Nederland is bijna 3 jaar bezet. Een Duits bezettingsbestuur heeft de macht overgenomen. Op de Katholieke Universiteit Nijmegen gaan de colleges zoveel mogelijk door, ook al laten de oorlogsomstandigheden zich nadrukkelijk gelden. Boeken uit de bibliotheek zijn verboden. Het studentenkoor Carolus Magnus is ontbonden en hoogleraren en studenten zijn gearresteerd op last van de bezetter. De spanning stijgt, terwijl de onvrede groeit. Een nieuwe maatregel van de bezetter houdt de gemoederen bezig. De universiteiten moeten een loyaliteitsverklaring voorleggen aan hun studenten. Wie tekent, mag blijven studeren. Wie weigert, wordt mogelijk aan het werk gezet in Duitsland. Studenten stellen zichzelf de vraag, zal ik gaan tekenen of niet?
So the dilemma the students were facing at that specific time is also built into the escape room we rebuilt. They also have to make the choice, the players of that room, Do I or do I not sign this specific formula? Oh. How do you shut YouTube up? That's a big question. Okay. So, let me just come to sort of a conclusion of what I think we are tracing down. And I want to emphasize, I don't consider myself an expert. I consider myself an investigator or a pioneer or maybe a try-outer. Not yet an expert, because I really don't think the field of immersive experiences in education already allows us to call ourselves experts. I think we should enjoy the journey instead of pretending to already know the answer to a lot of questions. What I do know, however, is as yesterday evening we met with a couple of you guys, and you told me about the question, how do we engage people into a lifelong learning? Well, I know for one thing for certain, it isn't by books, and it isn't by knowledge. I think the entrance to engaging people is by their heart. And I think if your goal is really to engage people into a lifelong learning, and you want to enter it by the heart, immersive experiences might just be the holy grail of the next phases of learning to come. I thank you.